In this video, we're going to give our final example of a tensor in this video series, which is the metric tensor. The metric tensor is something that helps us measure lengths and angles in space. So to start off, I'll ask the question, how do you get the length of a vector? So let's say I have this vector v living in this two-dimensional space here with the following components. How do I get its length? So we can think of the vector v as the longest side of a right-angled triangle whose other two sides are parallel with the basis vectors e1 and e2. And if you remember your elementary school math, seeing a right-angled triangle should make you think of Pythagoras' theorem, right? So c squared equals a squared plus b squared, where c is the longest side of a right-angled triangle. So in this case, a is the side length along the e1 direction, and b is the side length along the e2 direction. And given the column vector 1, 2, this ends up being 1 squared plus 2 squared, which is 5. But that's the square of the length of v, so to get the actual length we have to take the square root, and that gives us the square root of 5, which is approximately 2.236. So that's computing the length in the old basis. Let's try computing it in the new basis. So we can try going through the same process here using the components in the new basis, which are 5 over 4, 3. But applying those to Pythagoras' theorem, we get that the squared length is 169 over 16. And taking the square root of that, we get exactly 3.25. So what's up here? Why didn't this work? Why didn't we get the square root of 5 like we were expecting? And the reason we messed up, of course, is that we used the side lengths of this triangle here, where one side is given by v, and the other two sides are parallel to e1 tilde and e2 tilde. And that isn't a right-angled triangle. So really, Pythagoras' theorem is a bit of a lie for non-orthonormal coordinate systems. Okay, it only works when the basis vectors have length 1 and are at right angles to each other. So it's not really a lie, but Pythagoras' theorem only works for getting vector lengths in the very special case where we have an orthonormal coordinate system. And this fact isn't really that surprising. In fact, if we play around with different coordinate systems, where a vector v is always parallel to one of the basis vectors, it becomes pretty obvious that this formula, Pythagoras' theorem, doesn't work. So in this A coordinate system, where the basis vector a1 is the same length as v, Pythagoras tells us the squared length of v is 1. And in this B coordinate system, where b1 is shorter than v, Pythagoras gives us a squared length of 4. And in this C coordinate system, c1 is longer than v, and Pythagoras gives us a squared length of 4 over 9. So we know that in the case of general non-orthonormal coordinate systems, Pythagoras' theorem is no good to us. So what do we do? So it turns out that the real formula for vector length isn't given by Pythagoras, it's given by the dot product. So the squared length of the vector v is equal to v dot v. And expanding v out in the old basis, we get this. And we can distribute this just like we would a normal algebra expression involving multiplication. So we just group the terms for first, outer, inner, and last, and so we get this. And simplifying this a little, and using our knowledge that e1 dot e2 is the same thing as e2 dot e1, because the dot product doesn't care about the order of the inputs, we get this formula for the length here. And of course, this also applies for the new coordinate system. We can just replace the e basis vectors with the e tilde basis vectors, and we replace the v components with the v tilde components. Okay, so let's give these formulas a try. So writing it out in the old basis again here, and since the old basis is an orthonormal basis, we can use this rule here where ei dot ej gives us the Kronecker delta. And that means when the indices are the same, we get 1. So e1 dot e1 and e2 dot e2 both give us 1. And when the indices are different, we get 0. So e1 dot e2 goes to 0. And what we're left with is Pythagoras' theorem, right? C squared equals a squared plus b squared. So the real formula for vector length is up here. But since this is an orthonormal coordinate system, all of these dot products work out to really simple answers, and we get a much simpler formula, which is Pythagoras' theorem. But of course, that wouldn't work down here in the new basis, because the basis dot products are going to work out to be different numbers. So to compute these dot products, we can just replace the set of new basis vectors with linear combinations of the old basis vectors using the forward transform. So we can write e1 tilde dot e1 tilde as this here, and churning through the math, we get this. And we can set these two dot products to 1, and this dot product to 0, because the bold basis is orthonormal. And so we get e1 tilde dot e1 tilde is equal to 5. And we can do the same thing with e2 tilde dot e2 tilde, and we get 5 over 16. And finally, we can do the same thing for e1 tilde dot e2 tilde, and we get negative 3 quarters. So we've computed all three dot products that we need right here with the new basis, and that means we can plug them into the formula for the squared vector length here, and we end up with this formula here. So this is the formula for computing the vector length in the new basis. And we can sort of think of this as Pythagoras' theorem for the new basis, where we have an additional term and different scaling constants. So let's plug in the components of v in the new basis to our formula for the squared length of v. And if we churn through all this, we see that we get 5. And so, of course, the length of v is the square root of 5, which is the answer that we're expecting. So this formula, where we compute v dot v, actually gives us the right answer for the squared vector length in all coordinate systems. And if we go back to our examples here, we can see why this new formula works in general. The reason is that when a vector's components get bigger, the basis vectors are going to get smaller. So when we're going from A to B here, the components are growing from 1 to 2, but b1.b1 will shrink compared to a1.a1. So the growing of the components and the shrinking of the dot product of the basis vectors is going to balance out, and the length will be the same. And the same thing applies over here. When the components shrink, this dot product of the basis vectors will grow to balance things out, and the length will stay the same. So we have these formulas here for the squared vector length, and you'll notice that we can write this formula for the old components as a series of matrix multiplications like this. And if you work this out, you still get v1 squared plus v2 squared. And the same goes for the new coordinate system. We can write this equation as this set of matrix multiplications here. And so really, the key to getting a vector length in any given coordinate system is this matrix here. And this is what we call the metric tensor. And we denote the metric tensor by the letter G, oddly enough. So this is the metric tensor in the old basis, and this is the metric tensor in the new basis. It's the same metric tensor, it's just represented by different matrices, right? Just like with vectors, metric tensors are invariant, but they look different and have different components when we use different coordinate systems. So at the end of the day, to get vector lengths using these formulas, we really just need to know the basis vector dot products, and we can store these dot products in a matrix which represents the metric tensor for that coordinate system. So to get the squared vector length, we can just use these simple formulas here, and remember there are implied summations over I and J here, and again the metric tensor components are given by the dot products of the basis vectors. So earlier I said the metric tensor helps us measure lengths and angles in a space, and I've shown how it can measure lengths, so now I'll show how it can measure angles. So to start, we'll have our old basis, which is orthonormal as usual, and for this new basis here, we're just going to rotate the second basis vector a little bit so that it forms some angle theta with the first basis vector. So what I'm saying here is that e1 tilde is equal to e1, and e2 tilde is equal to cosine theta e1 plus sine theta e2. Because recall, sine and cosine are just given by this triangle here, where sine is opposite over hypotenuse and cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, and the hypotenuse in this case has length 1, because it was a normal vector that we just rotated. So let's compute the basis dot products in this new basis. We find that first dot first is equal to 1, we find that first dot second is equal to cosine theta, and we find that second dot second is equal to 1. And I figured this out using the well-known trig identity here, cosine squared plus sine squared is equal to 1. Okay, so we have our dot products, and that means that we can get the metric tensor for this matrix in the new basis, which we have here. And remember, this is the same metric tensor, it's just that it has different components in different coordinate systems. Okay, so let's say we have two vectors, v and w, and we want to find the angle theta between them. Well, what we can do is we can define some new basis where the basis vectors are pointing in the same directions as v and w, except that the length of these basis vectors are 1, so they're normal vectors. And now we can compute the dot product v dot w. And really, v is just some multiple of e1, since they're aligned, and w is just some multiple of e2, since they're aligned. So we can write v dot w like this. And now rearranging things, and recall that we determined when two basis vectors of unit length are at an angle theta, their dot product is just cosine theta. And finally, we just need to realize that A is really the length of V and B is really the length of W, because we need A copies of E1 tilde to get V and we need B copies of E2 tilde to get W, and so we get this. So what we've determined is that using only dot products, since these vector lengths are also given by dot products, we can compute the angle between any two vectors that we like. So this dot product, v dot w, we can just churn through the math and we can see that we can write it in terms of the metric tensor. So all these dot products between v and w can be computed using the metric tensor. And that means that this formula here for the angle between any two vectors can be computed entirely in terms of the metric tensor, along with the vector components. Alright, so hopefully we understand what the metric tensor is used for. Now I'm going to talk about how the components of the metric tensor transform when we change coordinate systems. So this is really easy to figure out. We just get the metric tensor components in the new coordinate system using these dot products involving the e tildes. Now using the forward transform, we can write these in terms of the old basis, and we get this dot product. And those are just the components of the metric tensor in the old coordinate system. So we get this transformation rule where we go from old to new using two forward transformations. And likewise, for the inverse process, to get from new to old, we use two backward transformations. And using these transformation rules, we can go through really quick here and confirm that the squared length of a vector remains constant over all coordinate systems. So we start with this formula for the squared length in the new basis. Then using our transformation rules to move from the new to the old coordinate system, we can transform the vector components, as well as the metric tensor coordinates, back to the old basis, using the rule we just learned. And we find that we get two forward transformations and two backward transformations. And these both cancel out to give us two Kronecker deltas. And using the index canceling rule for Kronecker delta, we find that we just get this formula here, which is exactly what we are expecting for the old coordinate system. So in fact, this formula using the metric tensor works in all coordinate systems, and the vector length will stay constant. So summing up everything we've learned in this video series, we've learned about the contravariant transformation rule, and this applies to basis covectors and vector components, and they're called 1-0 tensors. We've learned about the covariant transformation rule, which is used for basis vectors and covector components, and we call those 0-1 tensors. We've learned about linear maps, which are 1-1 tensors, and those transform using one contravariant rule and one covariant rule. And finally, we learned about the metric tensor, which is a 0-2 tensor, because it transforms using two covariant rules. So way back at the beginning of this video series, I gave you this definition of tensors. I said that tensors are objects that are invariant under a change of coordinates, and have components that change in some special predictable way under a change of coordinates. So you're finally ready for me to tell you what this special predictable rule is. The transformation rule that tensors will obey is this. So this probably looks really complicated, but all it's saying is that if we have some object with components, and some of those components are upstairs, which are the contravariant components, and then some components are downstairs, which are the covariant components, the way we transform them is just by applying a series of forward and backward transforms. So in the forward direction, going from old to new, all these upstairs indices will transform using the backward transformation, like these ijks, and the downstairs indices will transform using the forward transformations, like here with the rsts. And the reverse transformation from new to old, it's the same thing but opposite. We replace the forward transforms with backward transforms, and we replace the backward transforms with forward transforms. So anything that follows these rules when changing coordinates, whether it's with one transform or whether it's with 20, anything that follows these rules is a tensor. And I've already sort of hinted at this, but just to make it clear, when a tensor has m upstairs contravariant indices and n downstairs covariant indices, we call that tensor an mn tensor. So these two numbers are called the tensor's type, and they tell us how many contravariant and covariant rules we need to follow when transforming a tensor. And the last thing I'm going to say, you may recall this other definition I gave for tensors, where I said that tensors are just collections of vectors and covectors combined using the tensor product, and I told you that this was the best definition for tensors that we can come up with. So we know what vectors are, and we know what covectors are. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go through an explanation of the tensor product. And once we understand what the tensor product is, we'll understand this best definition of tensors here.